Welcome to Alaska Weather, a production of Alaska Public Media and the National Weather Service, Alaska Region. Produced and broadcast daily from the studios of KAKM, Alaska Weather provides complete forecasts, public, marine, and aviation for all of Alaska. Alaska Weather is made possible by the following sponsors.
Sometimes the best way to find a living is to stay right where you are and study with UAS online. Career-specific distance programs from the University of Alaska Southeast are the fastest way to increase your earning power.
We connect all over the world.
The National Weather Service.
And good Tuesday, everyone. I'm meteorologist Dave Snider with you on this 10th of May. As always, we encourage you to stay up to date with your local weather information by going to weather.gov/Alaska. And in the coming weeks, if you haven't noticed already, things are changing a little bit. Be sure and check out our beta site. It's a, you know, kind of a test site, and make sure we're working out the bugs before we turn that into the real site. Things are going to look a little different. They'll probably behave a little bit differently, but the whole goal is to make them work better for you and do what you need them to do a little bit faster and a little bit easier. So make sure you check that out and let us know what you find. Try and break it for us and let us know how we can improve that before we kind of flip the switch for good. The weather info line is open at 800-472-0391. As always, we're not expecting to change that. On Facebook, you can find information all day long and in between the Alaska weather shows at NWS Alaska. And Twitter, AKwx is the hashtag to use to let us know you're taking pictures of Alaska weather. Even if we're not friends on Facebook or Twitter, you can always message us in those ways and we'll see that. On YouTube, look for NWS Alaska or NWS Anchorage to get your daily afternoon map briefing. And if you search for AKwx TV, you'll find this entire program and all the other ones way back in history there. You can go back and watch your favorite episodes, you know, the ones that you always like to, you know, queue up there at the end of the weekend there with a bowl of pop. Maybe not. You don't do that. That's what I do. Okay. Here's a look at the hazardous weather. Now let's get started around the Alaska range. And the bright yellow areas here are wind advisories. We're expecting some gusty weather there. Southerly winds working through the gaps could produce some gusts through some of the higher terrain there, especially up to 45 miles per hour. Looking for 35 mile an hour gusts across the eastern Alaska range. So watch for some stronger gusts from time to time. If you're flying, that's probably going to create a little bit of a turbulence opportunity. And that mainly goes through midnight tonight. So we're not expecting this to continue long term into the rest of the week. If you're driving a high profile vehicle, and there's more and more of those on the Parks Highway and the Denali Highway and the Richardson, just keep in mind that you might have to hold on to the wheel for a few extra minutes going through some of those passes there. So just be careful and be prepared. Out across the northwestern Brooks Range, in the Noatak and Kobuk Valleys there, we are looking at flood watches, watching for the potential for some heavy rain. And some persistent rain really is going to be the key here, as we're setting up a several-day pattern that's going to soak parts of the west coast and the interior of the Seward Peninsula and the south-facing coastline of the Seward Peninsula, including areas around Nome. Now, you'll notice that's not orange. That is certainly a different color. The yellow is an advisory as well. This is a flood advisory rather than a flood watch. We're thinking that conditions will probably have an opportunity to produce some flooding, but probably not looking quite as severe at this point. We're also looking for conditions to develop a little bit later, and we're a little less sure about that right now for the northwestern mountains. So we're still watching, but we are pretty sure we're going to see some runoff and some melt across the interior and the south-facing coastline. So flooding conditions may be possible there. And if that means that your roadway that you is in between you and wherever you're going is flooded, make sure you turn around and don't drown. If that comes up fairly quickly, of course, it doesn't take a whole lot to float you and your car along with it. And no cars or trucks will float. They just don't. I've seen a duck float, but I've never seen a car or truck float. So be extra careful and remember your safety rules. And I got to tell you, the kids remember those the best. Teach your kids that rhyme. Turn around, don't drown. And they'll remind you for the rest of your life. Mine do it all the time. It's great. Here's a look at the breakup map. May 10th from about 10:30. And you'll notice everything south of the Yukon is either open or mostly open. Right here. So anything north of Circle, and boy, everything looks great on the south side. Now, changes are coming already to the Sag River. The warmer air lifting northward is going to really start to change things up probably in the next week to week and a half, maybe even 2 weeks. So watch for conditions there along the Colville and the Sag to change, and that could have some impacts on the roadway. We're waiting to see like you are. And the Kobuk and Noatak valleys, there already changes there. Just about done, it looks like. Conditions are either some open or mostly open for most of that region. A little unknown there for the upper Kobuk, it looks like. But look for changes to improve there. And if you have any information to share, we certainly encourage that. Make sure you email us or tag us on Facebook, whatever you'd like to do. Pictures are great, too. Now, as we turn from breakup to more fire dangerous, conditions remain dry for many locations. We're watching high fire danger that's somewhat limited right now. West of Lake Clark and Merrill Pass and Rainy Pass, expecting to see somewhat high, maybe high moderate, if worst, west of the range. North of the Alaska Range into the Tanana Valley, we have high fire danger around the Fairbanks area. And then north of, let's say Tanana, and then south of the Brooks Range, on the south-facing summits, we have some limited high fire danger there. But the good news is everything out in the west should have high humidity and at least additional moisture. Why? Well, look at this big swath of white. This is moisture coming deep from the tropics all the way across the Alaska Peninsula, the southwest, the YK Delta, Norton Sound, Seward Peninsula, Kotzebue Sound, and the northwest slopes of the Brooks Range, and maybe in some cases across the northern coastal plain in the Chukchi Coast. This is going to continue for the next couple days. We have weather systems that have just decided to set up shop here and don't feel like moving. We have low pressure in the Bering Sea. We have high pressure out across the Gulf of Alaska, and neither one of them want to move and get on about their business. So what we have is a very healthy conveyor belt of weather. Here's a visible satellite picture, and you'll notice things were fairly nice across southeast. That will continue because the weather's not moving. High pressure's here. Every bit of nice weather we had across the interior should continue. Weather's not moving. It looks like you've got a couple more days of that. But all of this is really just focused from south to north right here. It's, I wouldn't quite say fire hose, but it is certainly a little bit of a watering hose or a watering can blowing from south to north. And you can see that fairly quickly. Look at that, just hovering right over the same old spot. So this should pretty much stay in the same place as we go into Thursday, and maybe in some cases Friday, although there is some indication that high pressure is going to set up more of an offshore flow, so some areas may see slightly drier weather as we move into Friday. Low pressure out in the west, well, if you're under low clouds and kind of a murky situation out there, that probably won't change a whole lot for places like Adak and Atka and Shemya, and maybe the Pribilofs there as well, seeing some passing showers. And it's still cold enough out in the west for some areas of rain and snow to mix. Here's the surface chart. Here's that high pressure system. There's that low pressure system. I don't think you're going to see them move very much. Looks like that frontal boundary is already dying out as it approaches the west coast. We did see a few showers and thunderstorms across western Yukon and northern parts of British Columbia today. But that was it. I was watching for activity up here across the central and eastern interior. Didn't see a whole lot, which is probably good. You probably want the moisture. You probably do not want the thunder and lightning that goes along with it. Out across the west, you'll notice that corridor of wet weather continues, again, from the Noatak and Kobuk Valleys southward into the Seward Peninsula. And once again, a flood advisory is posted for your region. Still watching for flooding potential across the northwestern Brooks Range. Rain for Kodiak Island, trying to work up the Cook Inlet, probably reaching Homer to about Kenai, but that's about where things start to dry up as you head into south central. The Cook Inlet and the Matanuska Valley right now look pretty dry. Probably more clouds than wet weather, but keep an eye out for an errant shower or two. Across southwestern Alaska, Bristol Bay, look for periods of light to moderate rain. And there's still that opportunity for rain and snow to mix across the Gulf of Anadyr, St. Lawrence Island, through the Bering Strait. But that same warm weather is chewing away at the ice in the Chukchi Sea. We'll have that update coming for you in a bit. For southeast, there could be a few areas of light rain trying to sneak into the Dixon entrance, but it really looks like the bulk of southeast weather will be dry through Wednesday and through Thursday. Good news there. Watch for fog in the morning, especially under that high pressure ridge in the Gulf. Some of that could extend into some of the valleys in south central, the Copper River Basin, and the interior. But by and large, the most greatest, easiest effect to find from this weather pattern will be the rain across the west. Now, it does look like some of this will start to dry out as we get the more stable air starting to squash the rain chances across the west as early as Thursday, and probably by Friday we'll see some improvement there. Low pressure is also trying to develop across the southern Bering here. We see some indications of that there, so I just dropped a little low in there. It's only about 1,022 millibars, and of course it's all relative. this is high, this is low, but what's high to you, what's low to me, I don't really know. It just depends on the weather map and the day. But you'll notice a little bit of a weakness here, or a change in the weather pattern. So we'll keep an eye on and see how big that develops. But for right now, we do know that air will want to move off the continent toward that weakness. And if that's the case, it could shut down some of that rainfall across the west. So something to keep watch on there if you're looking for some changes. Here's the temperatures now across southeast. We saw readings today in the upper 40s to mid 50s. Ketchikan and Annette, fairly mild. Hyder made it into the 60s by late afternoon. 56 around Juneau, 52 in Sitka, around Haida Gwaii, 40s and 50s there today. 53 in Cordova. If you're watching the birds there, looks like fairly nice weather for you. 52 in Valdez, 52 in Homer, also looking like a nice weekend for bird watching there if you're traveling in that direction. 54 in Kenai, 56 in Anchorage, up around Talkeetna, mid-50s there. 63 in Toastie in Anchorage, 64 in Gachavite in Eagle and Northway. 63 in Fort Yukon, looking northward still. 50s for Arctic Village, 50 around Anaktuvuk Pass. Looks like Tanana hit 59 degrees today. Bettle 61. The Arctic coast in the 30s. Barrow was above freezing and now 24-hour sunshine. So back to that, or at least daylight, let's say. It may not always be sunny, right? 33 in Kaktovik, 40 in Wainwright, and 30s and 40s for Kotzebue Sound, 39 in Nome, 48 in Unalakleet, 52 in Galena. Looked like Grayling was in the upper 40s today. McGrath 54. And southwestern Alaska, Bethel had 51, 48 in Dillingham, 52 in King Salmon, 40s for the Alaska Peninsula, Sandpoint, Cold Bay, False Pass, all right about there. 48 degrees around Dutch Harbor in Unalaska, and 41 in St. Paul with upper 30s and low 40s for the central and western chain. Overnight lows in the 30s and 40s for just about everybody, it looks like. The interior, 43 in Fairbanks, 31 in Barrow, 37 for Nome, 30s and 40s for southeast. South central also low 40s, 44 in Kodiak with highs tomorrow. Low 70, 72 degrees, in fact, for Fairbanks, 77 in Eagle is possible. It's going to be a toasty day. 41 in Barrow, southwest 40s and 50s, south central upper 50s and low 60s. Another toasty day in Anchorage, mid to upper 60s for southeast and a clear, dry sky. Enjoy that. 49 in Kodiak and low to mid 40s in the Alaska Peninsula. Someone's going to say it's too hot tomorrow. Just wait. Around the west, IFR conditions to start the day along the Chukchi Seacoast and through the Bering Strait, through Prince William Sound, Kodiak Island, and part of Cook Inlet. Watch for improvements in most areas in the south for tomorrow afternoon. Southeast looks pretty good. MVFR over the Gulf and across the west under those persistent rainfall areas. And IFR continues for St. Matthew, St. Lawrence Island, part of the Chukchi Coast and through the Bering Strait, and also at times for Kodiak Island, the Alaska Peninsula and Chignik, and south of the eastern Aleutians. Here's your pass conditions. Anaktuvuk Pass expecting to worsen to MVFR throughout the day. We expect similar conditions there in Adigan Pass. So start early. Lake Clark and Merrill Pass see improvements after starting at IFR in the morning. Before Rainy Pass, watch for MVFR to develop by the afternoon. Windy Pass looking for VFR. VFR conditions expected for Isabel Pass throughout the day. Mentasta and Tanita Pass will probably head that way later in the day. Portage Pass, we expect to see IFR conditions in the morning. And Chilkoot and White Pass, wonderful. VFR conditions there and hot, as we saw. Tomorrow's freezing levels show that ridge of high pressure across the central and southern parts of Alaska. That pushes those freezing levels up to 8 to 10,000 feet out across the west. Certainly cooler there, but levels there across the west coast as high as 4 to 6,000 feet. Icing potentials there, though, as well. The moisture is certainly there, 8 to 10,000 feet and higher. It's where you'll have to wind up to find some light and maybe isolated, moderate in those regions. The jet stream shows our persistent southerly flow that's just racing across the west. That's where the moisture is coming from. That's the added energy to keep it going, and it's not moving. So we'll see that continuing with the ridge of high pressure right across the central and southern parts of Alaska. At 9,000 feet, we have southerlies, big surprise. 35 to 50, even 65 knots across the Seward Peninsula, a high pressure ridge there across the Gulf, and light winds moving offshore across southeast, 15 to 25. And also across 3,000 feet, southerlies at 20 to 25, maybe as high as 30 across the Brooks Range. So very similar pattern at 3,000 feet. We'll watch the same area for turbulence below about 4 to 5,000 feet. Watch for chop mainly along the southwest capes, Seward Peninsula, and the Brooks Range as we go throughout your daytime tomorrow. That's your aviation forecast. We'll be back with your marine weather in just a few minutes.
Alaska needs to wake up. They really need to wake up. Population is increasing in the state of Alaska.
The mindset of Alaskans has to change, that they are in a dangerous area.
The majority of our fires here and probably in the lower portion of the south central portion of Alaska are human-caused fires.
Our problem with children and fire escalates in the spring, summer, and fall.
All the aerial bombers, all of the helicopters, all the firefighters that there are that we have in the United States and the world cannot get in front of something like that because it's generating too much power.
In this part of the state right now in south central Alaska, we've got lots of standing dead spruce trees from the spruce beetle.
Black spruce are a very flammable type of tree, even when fully green.
Our weather's really changed. We have an earlier fire season now. The Arctic starts spring 8 days earlier now than it did a decade ago. That's significant.
Last several winters over the Kenai Peninsula particularly, the snowpack has been lower than people who have been living there for 30 years ever remember.
They build their houses right in among the trees because of the beauty, the remoteness, and all of those nice Alaskan things we like to think about. Yet, when they have a fire, then that is the exact recipe for having a catastrophic fire.
As Alaskans are very familiar with fire, we heat our homes with it, we camp out, we go fishing, we use fire all the time, so we have to be fire safe, you have to be fire smart.
Major issue that we all have to deal with. And you'll notice that many, many agencies are involved here today.
And I think that we really have to look at that here in Alaska. What are the things that we can do prior to the event?
Resources that we can put toward them up front are far, far, far cheaper than it is to have it happen after the fact.
I mean, it's not a short-term solution that you're looking for. You're looking for a long-term solution because you have a long-term problem.
Being the Lone Ranger out there isn't going to work anymore. It's just going to make everything harder.
Somebody next door to you or real close by that doesn't, and it wipes you out. It's got to be that involvement with the community.
And that kind of planning works not just for fires, but any kind of disaster, because we could have a major earthquake. Roads could get cut off. Structures could collapse. You might be counting on transportation, but if your garage collapses around your transportation, you might have to rely on your neighborhood.
They may not like their neighbors, they may not like their local government, but they have to interact so they can save both their lives and their property.
Fire prevention really is something that everybody needs to share in.
We don't sell fireworks in this area. They used to sell them right outside this door across the street. But that stopped about 5 or 6 years ago. And so fireworks and also the community here is really tight, and they pull together as far as fire prevention.
We are a highly trained group of individuals. We're very tight within the community. We're there to back each other up continually.
Get together as a subdivision, a little mini community. Talk to the local planning commission. Get that secondary access put in.
Panicked people trying to rush down roads that are heavily socked in with smoke. Visibility is down to 100 feet or less.
Those are the guys who are going to have to drive that truck down that one-way road. Those are the people that know their communities. So you need to get involved with your local fire department. Volunteer or otherwise.
Whether it be involved in fire prevention programs, community education, helping at the station.
Our equipment up to status, that we keep our training up to status, it's very important.
And they really have one interest in mind, and that is to help you help yourself.
They can also participate in community land use practices, in developing those practices and making them unique to their own community. community.
Your community council meetings, bring this up as an agenda item and do a little bit of pre-planning and a little bit of pre-thinking about these.
Local government agencies and especially their legislators.
We hope that our community and our local governments and state governments recognize that fact. Resources are very limited. It's really tough in some situations to make things come together.
But it still comes back to that community making a decision. Is this what's acceptable to us? And when it's not, then that community is the one that needs to work and change in that.
When in the springtime of the year, when the trees are crowned with leaves, when the ash and oak and the birch are new and dressed in ribbons fair, when I was cold, the breathless moon in the blue veil of the night, the shadows of the trees appear amidst the lantern light. We've been traveling all the night in some time of this day. Let me turn it back again. We breathe. To the shady groves and summon the shadows sleep, and tie a ribbon on the sheltering arms in the springtime of the year. The songs of the birds seem to fill the wood that when the fiddler plays.
The mustaches have changed, but the information is still the same. Here's a look at today's sea ice edge, and a lot has changed out there across the northern Bering Sea. Quite a bit of holes in the ice there, as certainly the low concentration ice shown in blue below 80% is rotting away faster and faster, and the higher concentration shown in white still hovering just north of St. Lawrence Island and southward towards St. Matthew. But here's what I was talking about. With that warm weather working northward through the Bering Strait, we can already start to see changes coming north of the Bering Strait now, north of the Diomedes. And starting to erode the ice and chip away at it across the Chukchi Sea now. So watch for more changes there. Here's a look at southeast, and look for north and northwesterly winds coming through the inner channels, about 15 knots with a 3-foot sea across the outer coast. North and westerly is about 6 to 7 foot seas expected, 8 to 9 once you get south of Sitka actually, and 20 to 25 knot winds will be expected on Wednesday. You'll see the winds shift a little bit more on Thursday as high pressure is starting to shift a little bit north and east. That becomes north and northeasterlies offshore then for many areas, 20 to 25 with seas ranging from 4 to 5 feet on the outside and 4 feet on the inside, looking for 20 knot winds all the way from the Lynn Canal down through the Clarence Strait on Thursday. But dry weather, it looks warm. For north and easterly winds, we go to the Cook Inlet, 2 to 3 foot seas there. Easterlies blowing across the Barren Islands from 15 on the outside to 30 after they pass the western Barrens. 20 knot winds there from the east over Shelikov Strait with an 8 foot sea. 2 foot seas on the inside of Prince William Sound, looks nice there. And south and easterlies 15 to 25 across the western Gulf. For Thursday, winds become fairly light. Again, high pressure is certainly in charge in this case. 2 foot seas through Cook Inlet, 5 to 6 foot sea over the Barren Islands, and look for an easterly flow over the Shelikov Strait region with 15 knots, 20 knots on the east side of Kodiak, and light and variable winds around Prince William Sound, inside and outside, all the way out toward Gore Point, 4 to 5 foot seas there on Thursday. For the Alaska Peninsula, southeasterly winds there will work across the peninsula and over Bristol Bay. That becomes 25 knots from the southeast with a 5 foot sea. Otherwise, southerlies are expected. 20 to 25 knots from Castle Cape to Chignik, all the way out toward Cold Bay and King Cove. 6 foot seas on the Bering Sea coast, 9 foot seas for the Pacific coast on Wednesday. Those become 8 foot seas on Thursday with south and easterly winds south of Kodiak Island, light easterly flow inside of Bristol Bay, and variable winds developing as we get into the Bering Sea coast and the Pacific coast south of Sandpoint and King Cove. 4 foot seas on the Bering Sea side and about 8 foot seas there on the Pacific side for Thursday. For Wednesday, across the Aleutians, a west and southwesterly flow with most areas looking at 20 knots, 7 to as high as 10-foot seas out in the west, even 12-foot seas on the Pacific coast there, all blowing from the west and southwest for Wednesday. For Thursday, winds start to slack off a little bit, 10 to 15 knots tops, but some of that will be variable through the central and eastern chain. Northwesterly winds feeding into it with a 5 to 6-foot sea, those winds blowing about 15 knots for Thursday over the western chain. For the west coast, again, this is going to be a little wetter situation here with southerlies working up the capes and through Etolian Strait and St. Lawrence Island, 20 knots there with 4 to 6-foot seas. The Pribilof is looking at 20 knots with a 7-foot sea. Southeasterlies over St. Matthew, those drop off as we head into Thursday, 10 knots with a 3 to 4-foot sea. South and easterlies all the way up the southwest capes and through St. Lawrence Island at 10 to 15. Look for 3 to 4-foot seas there on Thursday. And now for the north slope, southerlies will bring you warm air, and more of that is coming your way Wednesday and Thursday, 20 to 25 knots all the way through the Beaufort Sea. More of a southeasterly flow from Kaktovik to Prudhoe Bay and all the way out toward Point Barrow. Look for that to continue through Thursday, but a little bit of a change. The wind speeds stay about the same, 20 to 25, but you'll keep the southerlies over the Chukchi Sea, southwesterlies as you get toward Point Barrow, and westerlies and even southwesterlies as you get into the Beaufort Seacoast there for Thursday. So continued warm weather for you. A recap of tonight's weather. We're still expecting rain across the west, and some of you will see more of that than others. The further east you go, expect it to be drier. But along the coast, over the southwest, Norton Sound, Seward Peninsula, Kotzebue Sound, and northwestern Brooks Range and Noatak and Kobuk Valleys, you're expecting to see some wet weather continue through at least Wednesday, Thursday, and maybe into Friday. Now for the Kobuk and Noatak Valleys, we expect flood watches are posted for you. That means the potential for runoff and melt could bring water levels up. Watch for that. A flood advisory is posted for Nome, the south-facing coast of the Seward Peninsula, and the interior of the Seward Peninsula, and more rain for you tomorrow. Enjoy your day.
These forecasts are to be used for planning purposes only. Call 1-800-WX-BRIEF for a formal pre-flight briefing. Always file a flight plan before you go flying. The U.S. Coast Guard Auxiliary urges you to leave a float plan with a friend or the harbor master before you go boating. Alaska weather is made possible by the following sponsors.
The National Weather Service.